about your latest book was published in April 21. Its title is Artford Tribal Rituals in South Gujarat, India, a visual anthropological survey of 1969. This is a very comprehensive publication of photographs and reports from two anthropological surveys you did in the area of Surat in Gujarat. You did this in 1969 in cooperation with Haku Shah, the Indian artist and cultural anthropologist. You were 27 years old at the time. Before that, as an ethnologist, your main interest in research was Western Africa, Cote d'Ivoire and Liberia. In 1965, you had published this book on the change in economic roles among the Dan in Liberia. How did you get interested in Indian art, Indian culture, and how come that you ended up in Gujarat?
You mentioned my dissertation on African craftsmen and their work. And this was in 1965. Shortly before my PhD had been finalized, I was offered to become consultant for ethnographic documentation at the National Institute of Design in Ahmedabad. This one-year job was a great opportunity for me at that time, and it offered me a completely new worldview. My teacher at that time said once, a good ethnographer has two eyes. He should not be focused on one culture alone. He should always have two cultures in mind to be able to really see essential things in that one culture. I took that chance. But if he would have said, go to Peru or go to Japan, I would have gone there as well. I was fascinated by classical Indian art, but I had a very slight knowledge about India. I think it was more destiny which sent me to India than something which I really had in mind as a kind of my career.
What was the National Institute of Design at that time?
It was newly founded with Ford Foundation money. I was not aware at that time at all what Ford Foundation meant, but it was the most modern institute for designers, architects, graphic designers. It was based on ideas which had been worked out by Charles Eames on the American side and by Max Bill at the Ulmer Hochschule für Gestaltung. And we were a very young team at that time. We were the very first batch of teachers. I was given the official title as a professor at that time. And when I came, there was already Haku Shah, my future colleague, who was there as research assistant. And my job was to document rural craftsmen and the equipment they produced for villages and, let's say, lower urban society. It was meant to document what existed at that period of time, that means soon after independence of India, and have that as the base for modern designing in a traditional form for the Indian market, basically. Hakubai was already employed there, as I said, as research assistant, and had collaborated already with an American lady on a smaller project. And when I came, it was not that easy because I was really very young at that moment. Hakubai was 7 years older than I and had been an accomplished painter with solo exhibitions in Bombay. I had a very proper academic training as an anthropologist. I had made plans what we would have to achieve within that 1 year, which I had planned to be in India. And we came from two different cultures. Hakubai on one side was my teacher who really introduced me to Indian culture, to the caste system, what it meant for ordinary people, to etiquette, how to behave properly in an urban or in a village surrounding. He taught me basically the first forms of speaking Gujarati as well. And I must say, there were conflicts at that time, but finally we worked very well and very beautifully together in our first field work in Ratadi, in a village near the seashore, traditional farmers, Hindu farmers' village, which we documented for a book which then came out in 1970.
And then in 69, a new project.
Yes.
And why did you go to
Ahmedabad again?
To Ahmedabad again, and later then to this Surat district.
Yeah, I left India again. I left India at the end of 66, and then in 1968 I was offered the possibility of being representative in India for the University of Heidelberg with an office in Delhi. And I returned to Ahmedabad, first of all, to print the book of our previous research, and I needed a working permit as an anthropologist in India. Hakubai also had left the NID soon after I had returned home to Germany in that time. And he had joined the Tribal Research and Training Institute of Gujarat Vidyapeeth in Ahmedabad. Gujarat Vidyapeeth in Ahmedabad is the Gandhian University, which was founded already before independence. And Tribal Research and Training Institute had started a small museum for tribal art. Vimal Shah was the director and Hakubai was the curator. And it was Vimal Bai, his boss, who suggested that Hakubai and myself should do some documentation of one tribal region for his museum and for my own work, my academic work. And so this was for me the best opportunity to get a working permit officially through that institute from the government of India. That we went to Surat district was very simple. Hakubai was born in the Surat district. Hakubai came from a village or small market town, Walot. And in Walot, still his mother was living around in Walot. His two sisters were married. His brother was a principal of Adivasi are tribals in that region, of one of these colleges there. So when we did our first surveys, three surveys in tribal areas, northern Gujarat and south Gujarat, it was clear that Hakubai's home area is for us the perfect place to go.
How can one imagine your cooperation? What did he and what did you, and how has one, can one understand how,
you functioned.
You functioned a daily routine.
First of all, Hakubai not only spoke the local Gujarati dialect of the urban population, he understood very well the local Adivasi tribal population's language too. Around these urban towns, which were originally marketplaces, had developed slowly to administrative centers. And you have to imagine at that time villages had no electricity at all. These roads were still kacha roads, that means unmetalled, untarred roads. in Walod, where we finally had settled in Hakubai's mother's old house. During the night, the main bazaar street, where normally the bus plied during the day, was stopped. We put our beds outside on the road, slept on the road. It was a completely different situation from nowadays. And it was rather important to find a center from where you could function, and that was Hakubai's home. Whenever we worked, we both observed. I was basically the one with the camera who tried to document what we could see. Hakubai wrote down whatever he could hear. He wrote down in Gujarati and could write down the local vernacular of the people of the Adivasi groups, also in his own very fine Gujarati script. So in the evening, then we sat again together. I typed on my old typewriter whatever we had done during the day, and interviews and whatever we saw as rituals, etc., when we had traveled. So that basically was how we functioned well. It was always Hakubai who introduced us wherever we were and told the local villagers who we were, why we had come, what reasons were there.
So he had a very important role. Without him,
nothing could have functioned. Nothing. No, that is clear.
And how did you start your survey in Walod, the hometown from Hakubai?
Well, first, in February, we made a survey tour just to get acquainted with the area, meet the officials, find out which are pilgrim places, where are sites of interest, who are specialists, who can tell us more about the culture. And in April, we returned and then wanted to stay up till the monsoon starts. That meant for about 4 months. It's a fine story, I tell you now. We arrived in the evening in Walod, and next morning, before sunrise, we wanted to see a schoolmate of Hakubai's, Alusha by name, whose father was an important landlord of the village area of Ranveri, which is very near to Walod. And we went there, as I said, very early, because we knew the landlord would get up early. And when we arrived, we got a cup of charsh, of buttermilk, no tea, because tea was in Gandhian families at that time not drunk, only if at all coffee, by the way. And then when we talked to Alubai, he said, "Oh, wait a moment, you might meet my father just now." And we went to the landlord's office, where he was sitting on a cot, and in front of him on the floor was sitting an Adivasi young man. And we stood at the entrance, Hakubai and myself, and it was a dramatic situation. The young man had lost his father the previous night, has come to his landlord to ask the landlord to be permitted to cut a tree, a barren tree, which was not alive anymore, for firewood for the pyre of his father. And the landlord said no. He wanted money. He said, "It's my land, it's my tree, you have to pay for the tree." And the young man prostrated on the floor at the feet of the landlord. The landlord said, "Cool, you have to pay." And I remember very well when we suggested, Hakubai and myself, we would pay for the tree for the young man's father's cremation. Then the young man said, if you want to come, you have to rush, because it's a custom that when somebody died, the cremation has to take place within hours, immediately afterwards. So he went home to his place, we followed him, and when we arrived at the house, we could hear already from far off the wailing of the women, crying loudly. And since we had not got permission of the elders of the house, we stopped in front of the house, sat outside the house and waited. Not long, and then the corpse was taken out from the house.
Mm. And they agreed that you take part or document this? The young man must have told
to his family that we could. The official agreement was reached only later. Then we met the old Bhagats, the priests, the ritual specialists of the village, and spoke to all three of them. And there is a very nice photograph in the book where they sit and we just talk to them. So then they agreed and said we can stay for the next 5 days with them.
The Hado ritual took place on the second day. Mm-hmm. What is the intention of this ritual?
If I understand it correctly, they feed once more the deceased. Mm-hmm. And the dead has been cremated. The soul is now wandering around without a body. And first the family feeds him inside the house, then the women alone at the fringe of the field of the deceased. Up to there they can walk. And then the men, the male members of the family, at the riverside where the cremation had taken place. First, they built a mandavo, a house where the soul could stay for some time, take the food which is placed for the soul there, and later on the community makes a large feast where everybody participates, and where again some priests send out their own soul to find out where the soul of the man is and invite him to participate once more. At that time, the soul of the deceased is still wandering around, is not fixed to a replaced body, what comes in the next day.
Three priests, three Bhagats were involved. What was their role?
The main thing is to remember the dead person's soul has left the body and needs now a replacement for that body, for the flesh which is just gone by the cremation. We need a place where the soul will stay on in the future. So the soul has first to be found where it hides. It has to be called to the site, and then has to be fixed to a place which the soul likes. That is a stone, Katru stone, which needs first to prove that with a sickle that it can sparkle, that life can get into it. It needs then a chicken, a live animal's blood to be invested on it, that the stone has the function, can take up the function of a real body. And a figure is painted on it, the day of the death is written on it, the name of the person is marked on it as well, and the priest has then to put the soul of the dead into that stone. And the stone finally comes under a gummet, where it can stay for a long period of time now, till all memory is gone and the soul is vanished as well.
Hakusha and you both took photos. What was your equipment?
Yes, we both photographed. I had two Leica Flex at that time. One I used for color, using Kodachrome material, and the other one was for black and white. If I remember correct, mainly Ilford material it was at that time. Mm.
And this audio material we hear in the film, is it,
I took it there? Yes, yeah? I had a small Uhr tape recorder, which we used for interviews and sometimes at rituals. But the main thing is we did not want to impose ourselves at a ceremony to the people. Therefore, we usually tried, when we entered a place, we sat down on the floor or on the ground and did not move much anymore. And usually I tried that we are very near sitting next to each other, that we are not getting into our photographs constantly. And
did the people oppose or?
No. No, not really. They were so concentrating on what was going on in the ritual.
And it is amazing that nobody looks into the camera. I think today everybody would.
I think they were not really understanding much what was going on, I must confess. We asked for permission. Mm-hmm. We were always asking, especially the ritualistic people, whether they allow our presence. We even told them what we are doing. And you will find in the book a long interview with Bhagat Manjo Franveri, who says, did you understand well? Write down. Mm-hmm. And then he told exactly what the ritual was like. Mm-hmm. And now these words had to be spoken. What did I say? Write it again. Mm-hmm. You know. So it was their interest. It was a time when the older people realized the next generation is reformist.
Hakubai passed away in 2019. Yeah. Did you ever had plans to go back to this area? Has it changed this?
20 years ago, the Ukai Dam was built, and before long time planned, many villages were evacuated, and with the water system, the agriculture has completely changed. If you Google now Valod, you will see lots of gardens and beautiful.
And how was it before when you were there?
Oh, that was dry land. This was light jungle, hills, and you could have only two harvests a year. Now it's a very completely different area. Mm. I went with Hakubai's son, Partif, 1999, to Valod once more, and we wanted to find out whether we should do a new research there on the same area. But it was politically at unrest, and we were told better not.
In January 1972, 3 years later after this survey in India, you became director of the Rietberg Museum.
Museum director of the Rietberg Museum, I could not spend my time in the same region of India. I had to shift my interest again and again for special exhibitions. Orissa was the next. No, the next was Rajasthan with Jitendra Jain. Then came Orissa with Dinanath. Then specifically with Professor Goswami, my research in Himachal Pradesh, and with Venuji and Balanambia in Kerala. So I had to enlarge my interests and could not get deeper and deeper in one culture. Mm. So that is why this project has
took such a long time,
50 years.
But now it's published.
First volume on the potters and the terracotta production and the weavers who make the costumes of the women, the jewelry, all that has not come up till now. So that should still be worked on.